So here's an example to explain why maybe the situation's not so bad after all. So let's look at a particular example. We've got our input space consisting of, say, the first 10 integers. And our hypothesis space is you take an input, and then you just return whether or not it's greater than or equal to some theta. So that's a parameter. And now, how big is the hypothesis space?
What type is theta?
Let's say theta is a real number.
Oh, then it's infinite. Infinite!
Indeed it is. Now, on the other hand, what would you do to try to learn this? Can you use the algorithm that we talked about before to learn in this particular space? So I guess what I'm asking is there a way that you can sort of sneakily apply the ideas from before? Now, the ideas from before were that you actually keep track of all the hypotheses and to keep the version space. And once you've seen enough examples that are randomly drawn, you'll be able to know that you've epsilon exhausted the version space, and then ultimately any hypothesis that's left is going to be okay. So what can we possibly do to track all these hypotheses? It's problematic because there's an infinite number of them.
Okay, I see where you're going with this. So when I asked you what type it was, you said it was a real number, but it would have been easier if theta weren't a real number but were, in fact, you know, a positive integer, say, or a non-negative integer.
That's true, though there's still an infinite number of those.
True, but it doesn't matter because the size of x is itself finite. So any value of theta greater than 10, for example, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter because it'll always give you the same answer.
All right, so what if we only track the non-negative integers 10 or below? This would be what? It's finite. And it gives us the same answer as if we had actually tracked the infinite hypothesis space. So there's kind of, well, I don't know, you had a good way of saying it before. You want to say it again? What is the difference between kind of this hypothesis space that we're working with and the hypothesis space as we defined it?
So there's there's the notion of a syntactic hypothesis space, which is all the things you could possibly write. And then there's the semantic hypothesis space, which are the actual different functions that you are practically representing.
Yeah, I like that you can make a distinction between a semantically, say, finite hypothesis space that actually is specified syntactically infinitely. And you also had the example of a decision tree with discrete inputs as also being kind of like this, that we generally think about only ones that split on a attribute once, but syntactically you could keep splitting on it. It just doesn't give you a semantically different tree. So this is kind of at the heart of what we're going to be able to do to talk about how we can learn in an infinite hypothesis space, more complicated ones than this example here, but at the same time without having to track an infinite number of hypotheses, because there's just not that many that are meaningfully different.
I like that.